This week on Wealth Track, financial homework. Global investor Bill Wilby provides worldwide market guidance. Retirement expert Dallas Salisbury shares lessons on risk. And personal finance columnist Ron Lieber explains the rules for the new realities. Next on Consuelo Mack, Wealth Track.
Stocks rose sharply yesterday, driven by reports of good earnings.
Opportunity favors the prepared mind. BlackRock.
Hello and welcome to this edition of WealthTrack. I'm Consuelo Mack. The crash of 2008 has dashed the retirement expectations of tens of millions of Americans. Retirement losses in 401k plans are estimated at $2 trillion. As of the end of last year, according to Hewitt Associates, the average account balance in a 401k was down 28%. No wonder that public confidence has eroded in the prospects for a comfortable retirement. Now, Barclays Global Investors commissioned a study of 1,000 401k participants who actively contribute to their plan. And the results paint a picture of declining confidence in a secure retirement. 15% said they were worried they will never be able to retire. 31% said they were not sure how they will make ends meet in retirement. And 63% said their confidence in reaching their retirement goals has declined over the past year. So how can confidence be restored? Well, the Obama administration's answer is straightforward and broad. Just fix the economy and market psychology and the markets will recover. But the Barclays survey picks up on another factor separate from the overall health of the economy. 73% of all participants said what would most improve their retirement confidence would be knowing they would have a consistent, guaranteed monthly income other than Social Security. We'll be hearing more about how to secure retirement income from guest Dallas Salisbury, one of the country's foremost authorities on retirement security. He and legendary global investor Bill Wilby and New York Times Your Money columnist Ron Lieber are next on Consuelo Mack Wealth Track. How do you improve your chances of meeting your retirement goals? Will the investment climate help or hinder that quest? Well, our first guest was the longtime award-winning portfolio manager of the Oppenheimer Global Fund, which was rated the number one global equity fund for the dozen years he managed it. Bill Wilby is now a private investor, which enables him to put his considerable knowledge to work without the pressures of Wall Street. And our next guest is an acknowledged expert on retirement issues. He is the CEO of the Employee Benefit Research Institute, or EBRI. Dallas Salisbury has been with EBRI since its founding in 1978. Its mission is to provide objective information about employee benefit programs and financial security issues and help frame public policy based on verifiable facts. His most recent book is Retirement Security in the United States. And our third guest comes to us highly recommended by several WealthTrack guests. He is well-known to readers of the New York Times. Ron Lieber writes the personal finance Your Money column for the Times and oversees the Your Money pages on NewYorkTimes.com. So welcome to all of you. It's great to have you here on WealthTrack. And we've got a lot to talk about, very important topics. Bill Wilby, I want to start with you. After 18 months of investment and economic shambles, which is what we've basically been, gone through, we've had some respite in the markets. So my question to you is the worst behind us?
I think the worst is behind us, Consuelo. I think the banking crisis is virtually over, the banking crisis part. We're still in a deleveraging mode. And remember, you can't deleverage and lend at the same time. So there's going to be very anemic credit growth for many, many years as banks repair their balance sheets. But the market has reflected a lot of that. And I think we're at levels where the probabilities are more on your side to be a buyer than obviously a seller of stocks in here.
Now, you're talking about the U.S. What about the rest of the world?
I think the way I view it, it's a global stock market. We have different little parts of the world where companies are incorporated, but we really, it's a global stock market right now. The U.S. is the most dominant market, and I think it's the case for all world markets that we are that we're probably bouncing around somewhere near the bottom. We may go back and retest, and gosh knows when that would when that may happen. But I think again, if you take a multi-year view, you're much better off being a buyer of stocks after a 60% decline than you are when everybody's pounding the table that you should own stocks because they were up 20% last year.
All right. And, you know, Dallas, average 401k was down 28% last year, as I said, a figure that's very familiar to you. Mm-hmm. But, you know, you've done some research showing that, that actually the financial recovery is within reach for most people. Is that right in the retirement funds, you know, in even making some very conservative assumptions? What's the research that you did?
Very much so. One thing in 401k plans and other retirement plans is people contribute every pay period. And because of those contributions, especially people that are younger and have smaller account balances, the power of that dollar cost averaging in gets them ahead very quickly. If you take even the older individuals like myself that have been in a plan for 30 years, mm-hmm. it's harder, but we've done modeling that if I were to double my contributions and we were to just have 5% equity growth, it would take me less than 2.5 years to get back to even. If I just kept my contributions right where they are with 5% growth in the market, then it would take me closer to 4 years. But for that short service person that's new in the plan, they could do it by doubling their contributions in 6 months as long as the market came back at 5% return.
What about retirees who are taking money out of their retirement portfolio?
That's where there's a real problem.
Right.
I think one of the things that those individuals really have to redo is an assessment of, can I really afford to be in risky asset classes? Can I afford to actually lose the money? What is my time horizon once I'm actually retired? For those with reasonable wealth, they have time horizon. For others that may be retired, and the only reason they decided to retire was because they thought they'd get 10% compounded return forever without any declines, for them, it's a much trickier time.
Right, a rude awakening. So let's talk about that, Ron Lieber, because last year's experience was a wake-up call that you've written about many times for investors' appetite for risk. And so, you know, how do we get an accurate assessment of what our risk appetite really is?
I think people need to think harder about what it would actually mean to their budgets, whether it's their retirement budgets or their budget to buy a new home, if the worst were to occur, if we see a 30% decline or a 50% decline or a 70% decline. If there's any upside to what's happened here, Consuelo, it's that we now know how it feels to experience a decline like this. And that will
affect... Thank you for giving me that silver lining, Ron. I really appreciate that.
Right. We now know what it will feel like if it ever happens again. And people will invest accordingly. And the other thing you have to think about if you're getting close to retirement or thinking about your retirement budget, whether it's 10 or 30 years from now, is what would a 40% decline actually mean? Would you not be able to travel to see your grandkids at all? Would you not be able to make the charitable contributions you intend to make or leave the legacy you intend to leave to your offspring? And how would that make you feel? And those are the questions, the hard questions you need to ask yourself. This is not some sort of airy-fairy in the sky, what does risk mean to me? There are practical implications here, and people need to think hard about them.
All right, and this is, as you said, is a real wake-up call and a really good time to do it. So Bill, I think you just answered my next question, but you know, stocks are considered to be the risky asset. And
right.
So you know, how risky is the riskiest asset, essentially, now?
Well,
you're saying it's
again, I don't have the numbers on the tips of my fingers here right now. But if you were to look after a 50 to 60% decline, what were the average returns over a 20-year period from that point? I think you would find the numbers would be considerably better than the mean return from stocks, which is around 9%. So you'd find it up in the double digits after a decline like this, as opposed to after stocks are up on stilt-like P.E. ratios, then your long-term returns are generally below the mean return. So I think your risk levels for long-term investing right now are quite small in a big picture sense.
You know, but you said it's a global market, but there are some definite differentiators. We just had Nancy Lazzaro from ISI Group last week, and saying that really the policy response have been quite different throughout the world. And for instance, that Europe has lagged, the Eurozone has lagged the kind of aggressive policy responses that we've had here, or the UK has had, and therefore their economies at any rate will lag. So you know, I mean, where do you see, you know, is there risk developing in the global economies or stock markets?
I think the Europeans have lagged because they didn't have the problems that we had in a lot of areas. I mean, if you take Germany, for example, they had no exposure to Eastern Europe. They had no exposure to U.S. subprime. Their banks were in great shape. They'd had their real estate bubble back in the early 90s, and Germany's the dominant economy in Europe. And the idea of throwing money at a problem right now for them, particularly the country that experienced the Weimar inflation, they just don't want to hear about that. And so I think that Europe, I think, is going to be okay. There's some pockets of real disaster. UK's got real problems. Mm-hmm. Ireland's got problems. And Central Europe,
Eastern Europe
has got some serious problems. But the core of Europe is probably okay. Emerging markets, I think, could get very hit by the slowdown in the U.S. consumer. And I think that's where you're going to see some lagged economic impacts or in some of your emerging markets. I think particular China as well.
Now, interesting, because, of course, the common wisdom is that China's going to pull us out of this, that they really, even though they're going to slow down a little bit, that effectively they're pretty independent economically. So you're saying that China's got some problems.
I'm saying there's two sides to this. I think in a long-term sense, I think the consumption growth in emerging markets like China and India will do quite well. Over the next 3 to 5 years, they've got to adjust to a very different economic environment where they've been selling to the U.S., and that's been the key driver of growth there. And these adjustments don't just happen in 6 months. It means you've got to realter supply chains and all sorts of things. So I think China's going to go through a pretty serious adjustment over the next 2 or 3 years. They're going to have a cyclical bounce here because of their stimulus.
Right.
But remember, they're adding investment at a time when demand for their exports is falling, and there were already concerns about overinvestment in China. So I think their stimulus package could actually exacerbate the economic problems in China rather than
help. Oh, interesting, which is a very different view. So Dallas, you know, you have some, you know, we were talking about assessing one's appetite for risk, and you have some basic questions that you would have us ask as far as how to ascertain what our risk is. And you told me you and your wife are very risk averse. But so what are some of the questions that we should ask ourselves?
I think that first issue is, what is the amount of savings that you have? Over half of 401k participants have less than $10,000 in their account. Is most financial planners won't accept somebody with less than $250,000 in assets. That right now is less than 4% of American households. So advice that is formulated for a very small portion of the population, people have to say, does that advice apply to me? What is my situation? Am I saving for retirement, or am I using my 401k plan? As frankly, most people who are younger than 45, they're using it to save for home purchase, to send their kid to college, or for medical emergencies. And they take the money out when they change jobs, and median job tenure in this country is 4 years. So advice that says, if you're a long-term investor, the reality is most 401k participants are not long-term investors. We'd love for them to be, and that type of assessment is essential. Why am I saving? How much am I going to save? When am I going to need this money? What is the prospect I'm going to use it for the long term of retirement? And those types of, or would I rather save a little bit more, take a little less risk, and make sure that I don't find myself in a position of this type of a market decline just before I'm ready to retire.
Right. So that would tell me then that if you're just about ready to retire or possibly in retirement, that you really shouldn't be in stocks, right? I mean, it is kind of the litmus test. I think it was, you know, do I have an investment? What was it that I hold it, that if I hold to maturity, and maturity might be retirement or whatever, that I'm going to get my money back? That might be an absolute litmus test.
Well,
for
a new book that just came out from Columbia University Press, it had a very interesting analysis by an economist at the Brookings Institution, Gary Bertless. What it showed was somebody retiring having saved 4% a year for 40 years with historical market returns and retiring in 1999 and buying an annuity would get nearly a 90% income replacement rate based on that savings. Somebody who retired at the end of 2008 having done the same thing for 40 years, a 27% replacement rate.
Wow.
And
because
that's
the annuities are giving much less?
No, that's 100% equity portfolio. The portfolio was worth that much
less
in terms of what you could buy.
Right.
And so for an individual saying, this is going to get me to retirement, people at 12/31/2008, if that was where they were, they should have said, well, I guess I'm working for another 10 years.
Right. You know, Ron, you're a big fan of automatic savings and investing plans. Why do you think that they are effective? And are there some basic ones that we should consider?
They're effective because they work against our worst instincts. You know, we are not inclined to take affirmative action to help ourselves. For whatever reason, people have trouble picking up the phone or sacrificing the extra 1% or whatever it is. And companies are now finally getting wise to this, thanks in part to some legislation, thanks in part to some useful research. And they're now doing things like signing people up for the retirement plan on day one and having them take out, you know, 3% or 6% and having them put it in a target date fund and upping the percentage that they're saving each year or every year that they get their raise. And then you have to raise your hand and opt out if you don't want to be a part of that. And very few people do that. They know that it's good. They know that it's the right thing. But, I mean, just think about the blizzard of paperwork you get hit with when you started a new job. So many people just don't get around to signing up for the plan. And so, you know, all of this just helps us do the things that we should be doing but often don't get around to doing on our own.
And, Dallas, you're laughing because...
It's so true. It is so true. Is the numbers prove it? Is participation rates when you put in automatic enrollment can go up as much as 40%. When you do automatic default contribution increases, most people stay with it rather than opt out of it. And so defaults really have worked, and they've proven that individuals don't mind being put in the position of having to say no, as opposed to having to get around to saying yes.
You know, Bill, as a mutual fund manager, I mean, did you see the pattern that they're talking about? I mean, that individuals basically, they sell at the wrong time. I mean, they're fleeing mutual funds right now.
Absolutely. And the numbers there, there's some great research on that subject. I mean, if you even took the Fidelity Magellan Fund, for example, run by Peter Lynch, that returned, you know, close to 30% a year over a 10 or 15-year period, the average return for individuals in that fund was something like 4% a year because of buying high and selling low. And we see that all the time in the industry. So it's something that everybody has to fight. And we've also I've seen savings plans like what they have in Singapore, the Central Provident Fund in Singapore, which is a mandatory contribution, mandatory savings, and it's been very effective in raising the national savings rate in mm-hmm. Singapore, as well as providing people with a very secure retirement, which is, I think, kind of what I'm hearing from across the counter.
Right. So you know, Dallas, I mentioned in my opening remarks that 73% of the people in this survey really would like some sort of another stream of guaranteed income. So what's the solution to that? I mean, you know, how do we supplement our Social Security, essentially, and our lack of savings in other areas?
Well, the challenge with that is our surveys have indicated the same for many years. We just released this week our 19th retirement confidence survey. Mm-hmm. Confidence was the lowest in the 19 years, not surprisingly, with all the way down to 13% that are in that very confident category.
Right.
And essentially, it comes down to those individuals having to say, am I willing to give up the cash? And what research to date says, I want guaranteed income, but I don't want to turn all my money over to a third party. And given what's happened in these markets, the surveys also indicate that trust in financial institutions is at an all-time low.
Right.
Trust in giving money to an insurance company, people are very nervous about that.
The reason, yep.
And so the bottom line seems to be that unless the government, the federal government, comes in and says, we are going to create a federal guarantee program, a la FDIC, for annuities, the likelihood is people won't feel comfortable in handing that money over to a third party.
All right, so that's the topic for another time. Time for the one investment, and Bill Wilby, you're looking at something, what you call a balanced portfolio. What would you have us put in a diversified portfolio?
I picked an unusual investment this time, Consuelo. I picked the Vanguard Convertible Securities Fund. Convertibles have both the characteristics of stocks and bonds in their portfolio, and particularly bonds with credit risk in them. Those are the two hardest hit areas of the bond market. The convertible market was decimated back in the fall, and so you're buying it at very good levels. The Vanguard Fund is very conservatively managed. It's 5 stars by Morningstar, and it has a 4.3% yield. So you're essentially you're being paid to wait in
right.
this market. It's the convertible funds have much lower volatility than a pure equity fund, and yet you've got some long-tailed equity exposure.
All right, and I bet
a lot of
investors don't have any convertibles, so that's a very good diversifier as well. Dallas Salisbury, an inflation hedge.
Well, one of the things that everybody's saying is that when we have to get even with all of this money that's being put out there by the government,
right.
we're going to face inflation. Treasury inflation protected securities, either individual or in a mutual fund, and for your home portfolio, I-bonds that can be purchased very cheaply, no fees and no taxes until you turn them in.
And you wouldn't mind if we bought a mutual fund in TIPS?
Well, a mutual fund in TIPS is the way you're going to have to go in most 401k plans most IRAs. So, yes,
right.
absolutely.
Okay. And, Ron Lieber, you can't recommend a specific security, but you're saying that we all should have some international exposure, which will be music to Bill Wilby's ears at any rate.
Right. We want to try and work against our greatest fears. At a moment like this, when we don't know what to expect next, our tendency is to stick close to home, to invest in what we know. It's the sort of dangerous thought process that causes one to put too much of their 401k in company stock, right? Don't be afraid of international mutual funds. And make sure, if you're looking for foreign exposure, that it is in funds that invest in companies that are actually headquartered abroad, not,
right.
say, Coke,
right.
which has a lot of revenues abroad.
So that truly ends up diversify internationally.
Truly diversified, okay. and, exchange-traded funds, index funds. Don't try and bet on particular sectors.
All right.
You are not smart enough. I am not smart enough.
Thank you. So, Bill Wilby, great to have you here, private investor.
Thank you.
It's always a pleasure. Dallas Salisbury, thanks for coming from Washington, from EBRI, and Ron Lieber from practically across the street at the New York Times. Thanks for joining us.
It's a pleasure.
Well, at the conclusion of every Wealth Track, we try to leave you with one action to take to build and protect your wealth over the long term as well. And this week's action point picks up on the worries about paying for retirement and the desire that 401k participants have in a guaranteed monthly stream of income. So this week's action point, if you are retired or very near retirement, consider buying a fixed immediate annuity. Now, the benefits of a fixed immediate annuity compared to others is they are simple and relatively inexpensive because of lower fees. And a guaranteed income stream can take care of some of life's essentials when you've retired. And a fixed income annuity provides it for less money than a mix of stocks, bonds, and cash because the insurance company puts you in a retirement pool where the company assumes the risk that you live beyond your life expectancy. You continue to receive payments all of your life no matter how long you live. Those who die earlier than the actuarial tables predict effectively subsidize those who live longer. So for a 65-year-old male, a fixed immediate annuity with a life-only option, a lump sum of $100,000 will pay out $690 a month for life. That is a payout rate of 8.28%, and it's guaranteed. Now, if you live to age 85, you'll have received over $165,000, And if you make it to 90, you'll have gotten more than $207,000, which is not a bad deal if you live to a ripe old age. Now, there are downsides to annuities. In most cases, you are locked in for the duration. If you build in more flexibility, such as extending the payout to a beneficiary, you decrease your monthly income. So it's best to keep it simple. Keep the fees low and the payout rate as high as you can get, and make sure you buy your annuity from a financially strong insurance company that will survive. Also, seriously consider an inflation protection rider, which will more than pay for itself in several years. And we are seriously out of time on this edition of WealthTrack. Next week, our guests will include Treasury bond guru Robert Kessler and Cliff Asness, a celebrated hedge fund manager whose firm, AQR Capital Management, has launched its first mutual fund aimed at less wealthy individual investors. Until then, to watch this program again, just go to our website, WealthTrack.com. Starting on Monday, you can see it as a podcast or as streaming video. Thank you so much for visiting with us, and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
Opportunity favors the prepared mind. BlackRock.